In a galaxy far, far away here on Nerd Alert, we bring you all of the Star Wars content. Like I said, we are back here on Nerd Alert bringing you everything Star Wars. My name is Joe Veneziale. Joining me later is Nick Staso and Alex Hughes as we, in our first segment, talk about old Star Wars, anything from villains to movies to TV shows, all the way to comics and books. Going to talk about the old days and the great nostalgia that comes with it. The second segment will be animated versus live content on anything Star Wars, from Clone Wars to the new shows that are coming out. And speaking of new shows, our last segment will be the new shows that are airing right now, from The Mandalorian to Bad Batch, all right here on Nerd Alert. Welcome back here on Nerd Alert, and our first segment, like I alluded to, is going to be old nostalgia and anything in old Star Wars. And now I introduce my great panel, my two good friends, Nick Staso and Alex Hughes. Gentlemen, thank you for joining me today, and got a lot to get through, but absolutely. I mean, first one, start out, I mean, it's gonna be old Star Wars. We gotta talk about the original movies that came out. Nick, I'll ask you first, your favorite movie, and throw in your favorite moment from your favorite movie.
You and I have talked about this a lot, just because we like to banter back and forth. But my favorite movie from the original trilogy is Episode 5, which is Empire Strikes Back. Solely for the purpose of my favorite moment, which everyone, you know, when Darth Vader is, "I am your father." I mean, 8-year-old me watching that movie was like, "What? No way!" So I would definitely have to say Empire Strikes Back, and then, you know, the Luke, you know, he's his father. So.
Yeah. Alex?
For me, again, we talked about this, I definitely have to say A New Hope. It was the first one. It's what started it all off. I've seen the movie like a million times, and it's an amazing movie. Again, it started off everything, and as far as favorite moment from that movie, it's got to be the duel between Darth Vader and Obi-Wan Kenobi. I mean, again, obviously, in terms of some of the other lightsaber duels that we've seen in the series, it's not the most exciting one, but in terms of what it means, it was the first lightsaber duel we ever see in Star Wars, and that in itself is just such a great moment.
Anything from Empire Strikes Back to A New Hope, I mean, that's just classic Star Wars in my opinion. And just one key moment that I have, and one of my favorite moments, is just Luke's training scene with Yoda from when he gets there until it ends. It's just always will be in my memory as a kid. I mean, just seeing Yoda and Luke being to what he is. But moving from movies and, you know, kind of building off of that, you know, characters just throughout the Star Wars trilogy, and is there any ones that really stick out to you and hold dear to your heart?
I'll throw this to you because I have to think about mine still, so you go ahead.
So for me, it's got to be the guy on my shirt. It's got to be Han Solo. He's just so cool. I mean, everything he does, he's the guy in the, especially the first three movies, he's just the coolest guy there. The scene with him and Greedo where he just pulls out the gun and shoots him first, I will say that. That's a big thing in the recent times. But, I mean, he's just a really cool guy and just does everything. He's a good hero, too. And, again, he's just awesome. He's definitely my favorite one in the first trilogy.
Yeah, I'll probably have to say Luke Skywalker. I mean, I know it's basic, but, like, if you're a Star Wars nerd, you kind of relate yourself to Luke. Like, you know, you don't know really, can't find yourself in the world, and then, you know, these people trying to help you and stuff like that. And so, like you talked about with him and Yoda, like, that might be one of my favorite moments as well. He goes and trains with Yoda. You know, he's not done training. He has to fight a fully powered Vader at such a young start in his, you know, his Jedi training, and he promises to go back to Yoda, and, you know, he goes back. Unfortunately, Yoda dies, and then he becomes a Jedi, you know, master. So it's just the growth of Luke is the reason why I like him. So
yeah, no, it's same thing with Yoda for me. I mean, Yoda was just that mentor with Luke, and it kind of related to me, and especially it brought a lot of attention, you know, to Yoda and Luke's growth, like you alluded to, and it just kind of built the series to what it is as a whole. And that's just a big life lesson, well, should say a big life lesson broken down into a million different little life lessons. And Yoda, I believe, has a big part in that. But moving over from characters to any new media or anything that you guys have seen in recent years that could be considered as nostalgic Star Wars, as we have TV shows coming out, is there anything that really sticks out from the last, I'd say, 20 years, maybe your childhood?
I mean, I know we might talk about it here in a little bit, but that, the Clone Wars, I mean, they alluded to it in the second movie, in with, you know, Anakin Sky, like young Anakin Skywalker and Obi-Wan and stuff like that, but we didn't really know like what it was. But then they dropped the old Clone Wars show, which I never watched because I was way too young. But the one that came out in the late 2010s was a masterpiece. Mm-hmm. This beautiful six seasons. I know there's seven, but I'll talk about that here in a second. Beautiful six seasons animated. They went through basically every huge fight, battle that had something to do with the Republic. And then just about a year or so ago, they dropped that seventh season of the Clone Wars. And you're like, how could it get any better than those six? And they hit the iceberg. You can't go any further with the Clone Wars. It's how it ended was perfect. So I would have to say the Clone Wars.
Yeah, I also love the Clone Wars. I think it does a great job of looking at just what happens between episode 2 and episode 3 and just encapsulating everything that you missed in between there. But I'm going to go with a little bit something different. I really like some of the prequels. And my favorite one of the prequels is actually The Phantom Menace, which is one that a lot of people don't like. But I think the characters in that movie really make it stand out. And when I'm talking about that, I like Qui-Gon Jinn, played by Liam Neeson, great portrayal by him, and he's just a great character, good hero. Unfortunately, of course, he meets his end. But another one, Darth Maul. Is so cool. Like, the first time you see him pull out the lightsaber and you just see the double-sided blade come out, such a cool moment to see because, again, we never saw a lightsaber like that in Star Wars. And they just did it, not just in that movie, but through all three, they did a great job in making good villains because with 4, 5, and 6, you just had Darth Vader, and he was so awesome. But they did a nice job of getting a different one in each movie of Darth Maul, Count Dooku, and General Grievous. All three of them are absolutely great in their own ways. It just really encapsulates the best parts of the prequel trilogy to me.
Yeah, and then that's the one that I wanted, the first one that you said, the one that I wanted to allude to was General Grievous. I mean, General Grievous popping up on screen with four different lightsabers, and you don't know whether Anakin and Luke are going to make it out of that situation right at the start of the movie is just a core memory for me, and I will always remember that, and Grievous will just always be classic in my opinion. But
I do want to mention the masterpiece of like how smart these, you know, these creators are. In the Clone Wars TV show, Anakin and Grievous never met. They never met because in the third episode, Anakin Skywalker goes, "You're shorter than I expected." So the writers did like a perfect job of making sure that Anakin Skywalker and General Grievous had never met until episode 3. So I just wanted to allude to that because you mentioned Grievous and I mentioned the Clone Wars. So it's just like how they can just put things together without it crossing over and how it wouldn't make sense. Mm-hmm. So I like how they just stayed on a line and just everything makes sense.
No, it does make sense. It really does. It really just builds that story and gave, like you alluded to in the Clone Wars, Clone Wars has done fantastic things for our youth, especially, you know, being on Cartoon Network when we were watching those growing up as a kid, getting a different sense of what Star Wars, what it was. But, you know, branching off of that as well, Star Wars comes with a lot of objects and a lot of memorable items, you know, throughout the movies, series, TV shows, anything. Your favorite soul item out of all Star Wars, ship, lightsaber, the sky is the limit. There's one thing you think of Star Wars, is that's your thing.
I might have to say either the Millennium Falcon or Luke's green lightsaber. The Millennium Falcon, just because you see that ship and you're like, I know exactly what's going to happen. It's just going to be a bunch of misfits flying through the galaxy, you know, getting into trouble. And then, you know, seeing Luke's green lightsaber, he constructed it after Obi-Wan's blue lightsaber, and then he used the green saber, which in lore is like he's balanced between, you know, light and dark. So, you know, at that time Luke was at his most powerful, and you know, so probably those two things.
I think, again, I love the Millennium Falcon and just lightsaber in general, but I think I'd have to go with the Death Star just because it's such a great base for the bad guys. I mean, what better way to make your bad guys really hateable than have them have this ship per se, the space, whatever you want to call it, that can literally destroy any planet they want that's in their range. And it's just, again, it makes for a great scene setter as well. The scenes that they have in episode 4 and then again in episode 6 on the Death Star are some of my favorite in the whole like series. So I think the Death Star is just one of those iconic things that you remember from Star Wars.
No, I mean, great stuff all around, guys, but you did forget one important thing. Mace Windu's purple lightsaber.
Oh my gosh! Yeah, yeah, that's right.
It's purple. I don't know how much better you can get from that. And that's all the time that we have for this first segment. When we come back, we're going to talk about animated versus live content. But first, we have Keegan Robbie and Meg Berry for WoodTunes.
Welcome back to WooTunes here on Nerd Alert. I'm Keegan Robbie, joined by Megan Berry. And this week, we have a little something different for you. We're doing a country edition of WooTunes. So we're going to read off to you the top 10 on the Billboard according to Spotify, and then we'll give you our top songs from this week in country songs. So we'll start number 10, Love You Anyway, Luke Combs. We have a lot of Luke Combs and Morgan Wallen on this list. Megan, what do you think about this?
I'm a really big fan of Luke Combs. I like a lot of his newer songs. So honestly, this is on my country playlist on my phone, so I really enjoy this song.
Yeah, I like this song a lot. Luke Combs, always a great artist to listen to. I love listening to him and Morgan Wallen. But we have another Luke Combs song coming up at number 9, The Kind of Love We Make. What are your thoughts on this?
This is honestly my favorite Luke Combs song from this album, especially a lot of, like you said, the Morgan Wallen and Luke Combs songs that are on this album are from certain big albums that they just came out with. So this one for sure is definitely my favorite on the album.
Yeah, Luke Combs coming out with another new album coming up on March 24th. So looking forward to that one. He just released 4 new songs from that album. But I really like this song, The Kind of Love We Make. Like you said, one of your favorite Luke Combs songs.
Yes.
I agree. We'll move on to number 8, Heart Like a Truck by Lainey Wilson. Love this song. I liked this song for a while. It's been on the top charts for a few weeks. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I like this song too. I'm happy that it's not overplayed. I was really nervous that it was gonna get overplayed because, like a lot of songs nowadays, they're used a lot on like TikTok and other social media platforms like that. So I'm really happy that this song doesn't get overplayed.
We'll go to number 7 now. Something in the Orange, Zach Bryan. One of my favorite country songs today, and honestly one of the songs that I was going to mention this week, but when I saw it on the list, I had to think of some new ones. But Something in the Orange, one that I really like.
Yeah, definitely a top 10 favorite country song on my personal list. I love it, and it's no shock to me that this song has been on the top 10 since it came out.
Another one we have, number 6, Going, Going, Gone by Luke Combs. Another great song from him. I've listened to this song for a few weeks now. I love it. I think it's one of his better songs as well. What do you think?
I honestly think this song is underrated. I feel like it's not played a lot, and it's not looked at as one of the big songs from his newest album. So I honestly really like this song.
Next up, we have You Proof, Morgan Wallen. One of his more famous songs when he was starting to become big. This is one of the songs that kind of got him going. What are your thoughts on this?
I feel like it's a little overplayed just because, like you said, it got him big, it got him going. So I feel like this is the one song everybody knows Morgan Wallen by. So I think it's a little overplayed, but I do enjoy listening to it every now and then.
Yeah, everything in that playlist I think is also overplayed. But we have another one coming up at number 4, Thank God by Kane Brown. I like this song a lot. It's been on the boards for a while. I do a country radio show that you know, and I'm always playing this song.
Yeah.
I like this song a lot.
I like this song a lot, and I like the meaning behind this song as well. I watched a podcast about why he wrote it, and it's just very to the heart. It's just a nice song to listen to, and it's a different change of pace, especially for country music as well.
Coming in at number 3, we have Rock in a Hard Place. I love Bailey Zimmerman. I think he is really starting to show himself and starting to come out of little, like, not knowing, people knowing about who he is. He's starting to actually like be shown more and be played more throughout radio and being played on the top billboards more.
Yeah, Bailey Zimmerman is definitely an up-and-coming country artist, and I honestly think a lot of the people who don't like country love this song. So I think he's like pulling some of like the pop and like rap people into country too. So he's doing a lot of good things.
Yeah. Yeah, we have number 2, Thought You Should Know by Morgan Wallen, another Morgan Wallen song. I like this one a lot. I wouldn't say it's one of his better songs. I know why it's in the top 2. It's been playing a lot. I hear it a lot now, but I would not put it up there. I like the song, but it's not as good as what people think it is.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it's one of his better songs, but like you said, it's played a lot. It's pretty popular, so that's pretty much why it's so high on the list.
And the last one coming in at number 1, Last Night by Morgan Wallen. One of my favorite songs right now. and one of my favorite songs by Morgan Wallen. I hear this all the time. It's trending through TikTok right now. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, it's all over TikTok. And again, I think this is one of those songs that's pulling those people who swear that they hate country music into liking country music. And I really think that's what these new artists like Morgan Wallen and Bailey Zimmerman are trying to do. They're trying to get more people to like country music. But I definitely love listening to the song.
Yeah, so now we're going to say what our favorite country songs are this week. What are your thoughts, Megan? What's your song right now?
Outlook by Morgan Wallen. I just think it really hits home, and it's a different pace, like I said, of country songs. Like, it's more about, like, God and having somebody that's watching over you at all points. And that's different from Morgan Wallen, too. He doesn't write type songs like that. So I really like that he came out of his comfort zone and just made a song like this.
Yeah, so I actually have two. I was talking to you. I have two songs that I couldn't choose between. One of them is Hardwood Floors being Charles Wesley Godwin. Really like that song. I saw him in concert a few weeks ago at Stage AE, and he's kind of an up-and-coming star. Starting to see him a bit more in more country music playlist. I like him a lot. Another one is by Jelly Roll. It's Son of a Sinner. Mm-hmm. Really love that song. It's one of his best songs, I think. He's
also
another one who's kind of coming up. More people know about him more than Charles Wesley Godwin, but I think he's starting to really show what he's about and really showing up in those country playlists. But that's all we have for this edition of Woo Tunes. Thank you for joining us, and stay tuned for Nerd Alert.
What up, nerds? I'm Will Yoakum, here to bring you your Movie Minute. Up first, we have the long-awaited fourth installment of the John Wick saga, John Wick Chapter 4. Being directed by Chad Stahelski and starring everyone's most favorite lovable assassin, Keanu Reeves, this movie is all about John getting his revenge against the High Table. Wick must uncover a path in defeating the High Table, but before he can earn his freedom, Wick must face off against a new enemy with powerful alliances across the globe and forces that turn old friends into foes. This movie was originally set to release back in May of 2021, but due to the pandemic and Reeves' commitment to The Matrix Resurrection, this movie had to be put on hold. But we wait no longer, as in just a few weeks, March 23rd to be exact, we will all be able to enjoy the fourth, and possibly last, journey of Mr. John Wick. Next, we have the much-anticipated Guardians of the Galaxy 3 by Marvel Studios. Set to release in May, this movie had a lot of people talking about the future of the Guardians. The movie involves the Guardians trying to adjust to life on Nowhere when suddenly, parts of Rocket's past begin to haunt him. In order to protect the adorable raccoon, Peter Quill and the rest of the Guardians must go on a dangerous mission that could lead to the team dissolving. Current head of DC Studios James Gunn has confirmed that this will be not only his last Marvel film, but also the last Guardians of the Galaxy film. This movie is a must-watch for all Marvel fans as we see the end of the Guardians. And last, but certainly not least, we have yet another end to a beloved franchise among us. Indiana Jones and the Dial of Destiny, starring the one and only Harrison Ford, John Rhys-Davies, and Phoebe Waller-Bridge, this action-packed final chapter will hit the theaters June 30th this year. Set in 1969, American archaeologist and adventurer Indiana Jones lives against the backdrop of the space race. Jones is uneasy over the fact that the U.S. government has recruited former Nazis to help beat the Soviet Union in the competition to make it to space. His goddaughter, Helena Shaw, accompanies him on his journey. Meanwhile, Jürgen Waller, a NASA member and ex-Nazi involved with the moon landing program, wishes to make the world into a better place as he sees fit. Should also be noted that this film is the first of the franchise to not be directed by Steven Spielberg, and also not to be written by the father of a galaxy far, far away, George Lucas himself, with both icons taking executive producer roles instead. That is all the time I have for today. Thank you for tuning in to Movie Minute.
You're watching WCTV, where we aim to bring you the best local coverage of what you care about most. Everything from local businesses to hometown sports and the latest weather. We're keeping up to date with what you need to know about issues that affect our campus and our community. We're telling the stories that matter, celebrating our past, our future, and our potential. So tune in for all the latest buzz right here on WCTV Channel 14, Waynesburg.
Welcome back here on Nerd Alert, and our Star Wars panel in our second segment is going to be animated versus live content with anything related to Star Wars, and I invite my panel back up here once again, Staso and Alex Hughes. And guys, I mean, you had alluded to before about the Clone Wars. So just your overall statements between the animated content and the live content that has came out for Star Wars.
Yeah, so obviously, like I said before, the Clone Wars was beautifully done. I mean, they did everything they could to make sure that you knew what happened between episode 2 and 3. And alluding it to Mandalorian, because there are some things that obviously not everybody knows, like if you're not really into it, but like when we were watching the second episode of Mandalorian, when I was like, this is what happened with the fight between, you know, Ahsoka's team. They went into Mandalore, got Darth Maul out of there, and now it's in ruins. So basically, the way that they tie it together with the animation and the live action is just so beautifully done. And I'm excited to get more fan service from the, you know, impending Ahsoka show that's coming out that will be live action. But yeah, overall, I love how they just tie it together. So.
And they can utilize, you know, a bunch of different tools with that. I mean, like you've alluded to with the Lost City of Mandalore is in the new Mandalorian series, as the Mandalorian has bathed now in the Mandalore waters, or I should say the living waters. There's spoilers, unfortunately, but that episode is out. But nonetheless, Alex, I'm going to throw it to you. I mean, you know, including Clone Wars, you know, there is the anime series that had came out for Star Wars. I don't know if you've checked that out or just any, your overall opinion on the animated versus live content in recent Star Wars.
Yeah, I actually really like the animated stuff that they do as well. I mean, I don't think I can compare it to the live action because live action is always pretty much going to be better than animated. But still, that's not saying that it's not great, because I think it's great, because the Clone Wars, again, was a phenomenal show. It does a great job of tying everything together. And then I really like Tales from the Jedi that just came out not that long ago. Yep. I think what they did with that series was great, especially I really enjoyed the episodes that focused on Count Dooku and his fall from Jedi to Sith. I think that was a great series of episodes. And just, again, what they do with these animated shows is just tie things together, and I think they do an amazing job of doing that with all that they've done.
And now I bring the next question, and you brought up this term, fan service. You know, do you think that, excluding Clone Wars, because that was its own animated series, do you think that these other animated shows that are coming out are, you know, necessarily fan service, or would the fan service kind of be connecting it between the live action?
Yeah, so I would have to say that it's connecting it between the live action, because we, you know, in Clone Wars we get Bo-Katan animated. Yeah. And then they got the girl who voices Bo-Katan to play Bo-Katan in The Mandalorian, which is pure fan service. I mean, you get to see any of those characters from Clone Wars, like Ahsoka, like, you know, Hayden Christensen back as Anakin. Obviously, we've seen him live action before, but seeing him in it again after, you know, 16 years is fantastic. But there are shows like Rebels, which was purely animated, who tie into Ahsoka's story. So we're definitely going to see a lot of the Rebels, like Ezra, like Kanan, hope, you know, come into her story as the live action and, you know, just tie everything together. So.
Yeah, on the same token, I'm really excited for the Ahsoka series, because it's pretty much, you assume that they're going to have a lot of those Rebels. And Rebels, I think, was more of an underrated animated series from Star Wars. You see, because it came out before Disney, or like, it was either right before, right when Disney got the rights. And so it kind of goes under the radar, because shortly after Rebels, we got the new series of movies and then all these new shows on Disney. So I think Rebels has kind of gone a little bit to the wayside. So it'll be nice to see, like, those characters getting some more respect and recognition that they deserve.
No, I 100% agree with you. And, you know, moving away from kind of comparing the two, I've seen, at least in these recent animated series and as well as Clone Wars, they do a fantastic job at animation. I mean, Clone Wars, from being back in the day, I thought Anakin Skywalker on Clone Wars was modeled after Hayden Christensen, which it is, but it's just, it's so realistic, but at the same time unrealistic to where it is animated, and you see that, like, theatrics. Do you think that kind of adds to it, or is that just Star Wars being Star Wars?
Yeah, no, I absolutely think that it adds to it, because the first six seasons of Clone Wars, it was just full CGI. Like, it was full just animation. Like, there was nothing else to it. The fights were all animated. Season 7, however, with the fight between Ahsoka and Darth Maul, they did body tracking. So they went a completely different route. They said, let's try something new. You know, this fight is supposed to be pinnacle. This is the fight right before Anakin becomes Darth Vader. Like, this needs to be the culmination of all fights. So, you know, they said, let's do body tracking. And I think it was a fantastic idea. Like, if you haven't seen it, I think you and I need to sit down and watch it, because it is a beautiful fight while Mandalore is literally blowing up outside of what's going on. The fight was beautiful. So I think, like you said, I think it just adds to it. So,
do you agree?
I definitely agree, because like you mentioned, they mold these characters and animate them in a way to look like the characters that they were in the live action series. And I think that just reminds you of like what they were in those movies. And again, a lot of people have a lot of great heart and feelings for those movies, and just seeing characters that look like how they were, I think the fans love it, and I think it definitely adds into everything that you want in a Star Wars show.
Well, I'm very excited for any animated content that has to do with Star Wars coming in the near future or that are already being made. But that's all the time that we have for this segment. When we come back, we will talk about recent and future Star Wars of anything of that nature. But first, Darian Allensworth with eSports.
Hello and welcome to the eSports Talk. I'm Darian Allensworth, here to inform you about the latest in eSports. Starting off, we have some League of Legends news. UK League of Legends color caster Dan Ox Harrison has been officially announced as part of the LCK broadcast talent for 2023. Ox's move to cover the Korean League of Legends tournament series has been in the works for a while now, but via issues meant the announcement was delayed until today. He joins fellow casters Atlas, Valdez, Chronicler, and Wolf, as well as Hooney on the analyst desk as part of the LCK English language broadcast team. Ox said he was, quote, so excited to be part of such a fantastic region, end quote, in the official reveal. Ox is an experienced caster, having worked on plenty of broadcasts in the past, including the UKLC, NLC, the LPL, and more. Prior to his casting work, he played League of Legends as a support for the likes of XL Sports. The LCK features Korea's and arguably the world's best League of Legends teams, such as T1, Genji, and D+ Kia. Staying within Riot, Riot has denied policy changes on allowing gambling sponsors for Valorant organizations. Organizations competing in Riot-sanctioned tournaments in Valorant will not be allowed to partner with betting companies, contrary to reports. Dot Esports spoke to several team owners that said they were aware Riot is open to the policy change, but it remains unlikely due to strict gambling regulations in Europe, for example. A North American team owner told Dot Esports that they were not aware of a policy change. Gambling sponsorships are important investment opportunities for organizations. Many traditional sports teams are partnered with betting companies across multi-year deals. English Premier League club West Ham is sponsored by Betway, while NBA teams such as the Chicago Bulls, Cleveland Cavaliers, Los Angeles Lakers, and Golden State Warriors are also partnered with Betway, according to their website. We will see if Riot budges on their no gambling policy in the future. Dota 2 Old G is now back in Division 2 for this DPC season. A roster including Thompson, Resolution, Seb, No One, and Kitrack, this will be the second iteration of this team, as old OG fans, such as myself, rejoice that these fan favorites are now back in the scene. Unfortunately, that's all I have for you today. Catch you next time here on the eSports Talk.
Welcome back here to our last segment of our Star Wars segment here on Nerd Alert. And gentlemen, for our last segment, we're going to talk about new and future shows or upcoming events that are going to happen with Star Wars. But first, I'm going to throw it to Alex Hughes. Alex, tell me your favorite TV show or any new media and why.
I definitely got to go with The Mandalorian for my favorite. It might seem cliche, but I just think that especially the first two seasons that have been out were just so expertly done. It does a great job of showing the story of this Mandalorian going, and he finds Baby Yoda Grogu and just trying to get him later on to find a Jedi to train him. And again, I just think it's just a great job with great stories. There are some episodes that kind of delve off a little bit, but I think overall the series as a whole is just fantastic.
Yeah, I'd have to agree that Mando has been great the first two seasons. Obviously, the third season is still going on. But personally, I'd have to say the Obi-Wan Kenobi. I mean, come on, like, look at this. Look at this handsome human being right here. I like the pick, but I'd only have to say Obi-Wan just because we haven't seen Ewan McGregor since episode 3. So that's fan service in itself. And then obviously the ending of Obi-Wan with the Liam Neeson cameo right at the end, and then it just tells the story of basically how Obi-Wan saved Leia. You know, Leia talking about, you know, you helped my father, you know, you saved me. So basically you get that story of how Obi-Wan and Leia met each other and how he basically became another father figure to her. And overall, I just thought it was a fantastic show.
No, I agree, but I'm gonna have to say with The Mandalorian, with Alex, it's the one that I've kept up on, you know, most of the season so far. I'm fully caught up, but the first two seasons, in my opinion, were just fantastic. I mean, it built so much. Grogu is just an international sensation at this point, which was Baby Yoda for the longest time, but now we know that he has an actual name, and just the old characters that they brought in, and this new season is slow to start, but I'm very excited to see what we have in store for the rest of this season. As gentlemen, this is the way. But now we're going to move on to this second part of this segment, and we're going to rank, in our opinion, the shows that are out right now. And Alex, I'm going to start with you. Off of our list right here, just go from your least favorite, or should say not one that you haven't really checked out, and your number one.
So, and last for me would be Andor. And it's one of those shows that I haven't really watched a whole lot of because, I mean, I loved Rogue One as a movie. I thought it was a great movie. It was probably my favorite one of, like, these new movies that came out because it was just so greatly done and did a great job of setting up episode 4. But as far as this show, I don't really think that many people were clamoring down the door for a show about what happened before this, you know, Rogue One happened. So I'd have to have Andor in last place out of those. Then I would say Book of Boba Fett coming in next. Because again, as much as I love seeing Boba Fett back, as he was one of my favorite characters from Star Wars, it just show itself just kind of is not the most interesting. It's not the best. So I'd have that one there. And then after that, I'd have Bad Batch. It's kind of reminds me of the Clone Wars in the way that it does things. Focusing on the clone troopers is, again, great. I loved the arcs from the Clone Wars about the clones as well, especially the, like, Fives and Echo and those guys. Mm-hmm. And then Obi-Wan Kenobi, second place for me, because, again, like Nick said, seeing Ewan McGregor come back to play the character after all these years is just absolutely great to see. And then, of course, like I said, Mandalorian at number one.
Yeah, no, I really don't sway much from that. Andor, obviously, like Alex said, it's just kind of one of those shows where it's like, if you want to learn about politics of Star Wars, that's the show to watch. So definitely Andor, it has to be last for me. I'm going to switch it up, though. I'm going to say Bad Batch, which would be next. I liked Season 1. Season 1 was pretty good, and then I didn't really get into Season 2 that much. I did like the story. I thought it was nice seeing what goes on when clones who are rogue, who, you know, don't have the chip in them, like, what do they do? Like, you know. And then I would say Book of Boba Fett, only for the fan service of, you know, it's Boba Fett. Yeah. I mean, he's that guy. He's him, you know. And then basically, you know, that Boba Fett series basically became Mandalorian season 2.5, if you think about it. And then the last two are just such a toss-up, just because I love Ewan McGregor to death. He's a fantastic actor. I know I said it's my favorite, but I'm going to have to put it at the 2 spot just because of how crazy good Mandalorian is. I mean, season 1 and 2, the end of season 2. I mean, come on. Luke coming in at the end right there just to save him was crazy. But like you said, season three is a little slow start. This third episode was kind of a snoozer, but I think there's going to be room to grow for this third season. So yeah, we got a while.
We got plenty of season left.
So Joe,
yeah, and you know mine's not really much stirring further from you guys. I have Bad Batch and Andor right at the bottom. Haven't really checked out those two projects as a whole completely, but I mean I've heard good things. As you said, Bad Batch kind of relates to the clones, and I'm a big fan of that. But I haven't really watched Rogue One as a whole either, so I don't think Andor would really fit my needs for my Star Wars fix. But then third, I'm gonna have to go with Boba Fett. It's the one that I checked out the least. I mean, I did watch part of that first season, but I was kind of leaning towards the Mandalorian stuff, as you know, spoiler alert, that is my number one. But after that, I'm gonna have to go with Obi-Wan. As you know, these two alluded to, it's fantastic work. I mean, it's fan service to Star Wars fans, and that fight between him and Vader was fantastic. I watched that as much as I can, honestly, when I have the chance to. But you know, now moving over, well, as before we do that, number one, Mandalorian, full sweep on that. Cannot wait for the rest of the season. But then moving on to the last part of our segment and the future projects that are coming out for Star Wars, are kind of hinted at, but already kind of hinted at already by Nick and Ahsoka, but we have Lando as well, and that's the one that I'm excited for. The only thing that they need to do is just bring back Donald Glover, aka Childish Gambino, as Lando, and they'll fix it.
I don't think they should bring anybody other than Donald Glover back. I think I was a little skeptical, because personally, I love the Solo movie. I thought it was pretty good. I was a little skeptical.
It was good.
Right.
Yeah.
I was skeptical because I was like, you know, people know Donald Glover as a rapper, you know, and I thought he did fantastic.
He did.
I thought he was pretty good. And then, like I mentioned, Ahsoka. I mean, come on. Like, if you're not going to sit down and watch Ahsoka, there's something wrong with you. I mean, that is going to be one of, if they don't screw it up, one of the best shows, live action Star Wars shows I have seen. I'm going to put this out on a limb. It's going to be a hot take. It might rival Mandalorian.
I hope it does.
I'm glad you agree with me, because, you know, we saw the dynamic between him or her and Mando in season two of Mandalorian, and I'd just like to see how she grows from meeting Grogu and giving him to Luke, and like what she's doing now. I mean, obviously she's trying to find Thrawn, because that's her main thing with the Rebels, so I'm excited for Ahsoka, to be honest. Like, hugely excited.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat. Definitely, I think Ahsoka, again, can be a really great show. Getting to see, again, those Rebel characters back, it's going to be great. And again, it could definitely rival Mando if it's done right. And as far as the Lando show, I would definitely see Donald Glover back as well. I mean, coming into Solo, I was, again, skeptical, because you have these characters coming in, and they have big shoes to fill in these characters that have been beloved by these fans for 30-plus years, coming in replacing Harrison Ford and Billy Dee Williams is a hard task. But I think Donald Glover did a good job in that role, and I think he's definitely the guy. And I think Lando could be another really exciting show as well.
No, I 100% would agree with you, but a lot of more Star Wars to come is the main premise of this section and the main premise as a whole. Thank you, gentlemen. That's all the time that we have here on Nerd Alert, but make sure to check back on WCTV for all pop culture content.
This has been a production of Waynesburg Community.